Ladies and gentlemen, after decades of so-called progressive education, academic achievement levels have dropped so sharply in America that more than 1 million students graduate from public high schools each year as functional illiterates. The situation is so bad that a national commission reported in 83, if an unfriendly foreign power had attempted to impose on America the mediocre educational performance that exists today, we might well have viewed it as an act of war. Ladies and gentlemen, what has happened to American education? Who's behind this attack on our children, and what can we do about it? Our speaker has some startling answers. He is Samuel L. Blumenfeld, and no one is better qualified than he to take up these matters. He graduated in 1950 from City College in his native New York. After 2 more years of study in France, he worked for 10 years as an editor in the New York book publishing industry. Mr. Blumenfeld is also an educator, having taught in both public and private schools, including one for learning and behavioral problems. He has written extensively on educational matters, and one of his 6 books was described by Fortune magazine as brilliant revisionist history. His latest book, an expose of the National Education Association, quickly became so popular that it went into a 3rd printing in a matter of weeks just last year. Mr. Blumenfeld's writings have appeared in many diverse publications, including Esquire, Reason, Education Digest, Child and Family, The Reading Informer. He's also a contributing editor to the New American magazine that Eric Schau spoke about earlier in the year. He's participated in several important educational conferences on a national level, and he's frequently appeared in radio and television programs across the country. A member of the John Birch Society, he's also he's a born-again Christian, a brother in the faith, and tonight he will address the issue, are public schools harming your kids? Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm welcome to Mr. Sam Blumenfeld.
Thank you very much, George. Well, it's wonderful to be here in Southern California, really Southern California, after having been up in the north. Having come from Boston, you know, and expecting to enjoy the weather, I was hit by the rainstorms up around Modesto and Lodi, and I began to understand what they meant by trying to keep the public schools afloat. Just about everything was floating up there in that part of the country. But then the rains ended and the sun came out, and gee, it was so green up there. California looked like Vermont. I couldn't believe it. So it's nice to be here. And of course, here you have back in summer. I'm going to have to go back to winter next week. So it's quick changes. It's very difficult for somebody who doesn't know what kind of clothes to pack, you know, when you're going from winter to summer to fall to rain. Well, I guess that's part of the hazards of this life. But in any case, the subject tonight about education, this evening on the news, I don't know how many of you saw that San Diego news broadcast. They had a segment about a 45-year-old man who couldn't read. And they have a project reading, I think, in San Diego, whereby they are now teaching functional illiterates to read. And the lady who had done the story had interviewed the man and his wife. She didn't even know that he was illiterate. He hid it so well, you see, over the years. He worked at this job. He's been working at this job for over 10 years, 15 years, repairing, he was repairing some kind of, scales or some kind of equipment. And they didn't even know that he was illiterate. In other words, the functional illiterate in our society uses all kinds of methods to cover up his or her illiteracy. And we just don't know how many there are in our society. On the program there, they mention the usual figure that there are 27 million functional illiterates in America. That means 1 out of 5 individuals. But we suspect that the number is even higher. And of course, there's a great deal written about it these days. The other day on an airplane, I found this full-page ad in Business Week magazine, and it shows a picture of a man with a little girl sitting on his knee, and he's reading a story to her. And the ad says, to 27 million Americans, this scene is a fairy tale. That's because 27 million American adults can't read a child's bedtime story, can't read a street sign, can't read, period. Functional illiteracy has become an epidemic that has reached one out of five American adults. You see, it's like a disease. It hits you, you know. Yeah. This is an what is an epidemic, you know? I didn't know that illiteracy was an epidemic, but they say that it is. Don't catch it. Don't catch illiteracy. Gee, I'm coming down with illiteracy. Then they say, you can change all that. You can change that by joining the fight against illiteracy yourself. See, now you've got to battle against illiteracy. We're in a war against illiteracy. You remember the war against poverty? Whatever happened to the war against poverty? Did we win it or lose it? I don't remember. All I know is that before we started the war on poverty, we didn't have people living in the streets. Now, after the war, they're living in the streets. You know, they're homeless. It's a crazy way that we fight these wars. Anyway, they say you can fight, you can join the fight. It takes no special qualifications. So you don't even have to be a teacher. If you can read, you can tutor or help us in countless other ways. And then they give an 800 number if you want to become a volunteer against illiteracy. And then there was another full-page ad in the magazine announcing this new initiative by the ABC Television Network and PBS, an American Plus, that is Project Literacy US Plus. The goals of Plus are to heighten national awareness of the problem and to increase local efforts to provide help for illiterates within our communities. And they state that federal studies estimate that as many as 23 million adult Americans are functionally illiterate. Another 35 million are classified as semi-literate. So now you've got 58 million Americans who have problems reading. Well, you know, I thought to myself, people coming to this country must be very puzzled by this problem. You know, because they know America has the reputation of being the most advanced nation in all the world, in all of history. Technology is coming out of our ears. You know, we've got everything. Illiteracy in America? Well, this is not, you know, some banana republic. How can we have so much illiteracy? And I thought maybe some foreigner coming to our shores who read these ads might say to himself, gee, I've got to help these Americans. I've got some great ideas for them. And you might meet him, say, at a meeting of some kind, and he might approach you and he might say something to the effect that, you know, I understand you have this terrible illiteracy problem in America. I have a wonderful idea that will solve it. And you say, well, what's your idea? He says, you know what you ought to do in America? You ought to create a system of free public schools. If you had free public schools, you wouldn't have illiteracy, would you? And then you'd look at him and say, but we do have a system of free public schools. As a matter of fact, we've got a free public school in every town, village in the United States. And if you live out in the country, they'll put you on a bus and make sure you can get to that school. So we've got free public schools. You don't have to pay anything. You can be as poor as a church mouse. You can go to school. You can get an education in this country, all paid for by the government. Wow. So then he'd think, really? Oh, I know what you need. What you really need in America is compulsory school attendance. You see, you've got these free public schools, but if the kids are not going to school, if parents are not sending them to school, well, obviously, that's the cause of your illiteracy. Then you'd look at him and say, but we do have compulsory school attendance in America. We've got compulsory school attendance in every state of the Union. Even Mississippi has it. I mean, we require our children to go to school from, in some states, from the age of 5 right up to the age of 16. They must go to school. It's the law. If they're not in school, they can, you know, go to jail. Parents can go to jail if they don't send their kids to school. They'll be punished. Really? The foreigner would answer. He'd say, oh, well, so you've got free public schools, you've got compulsory school attendance. What could be the problem? Then he'd think further and say, oh, I know what your problem is. Your teachers are not trained. You see, what you need are colleges of education. That's what you need. Colleges of education, you'd reply. Well, we've got a college of education in practically every county in the United States. All of our teachers must go to college. They have to get Bachelor of Arts degrees. Some of them get master's degrees. In fact, you cannot teach in a government school unless you are certified. You know, that's the good housekeeping seal of approval. Really? So you've got free public schools, you've got compulsory school attendance, you've got certified teachers. What's the problem? Then he'd think further. Oh, I know what your problem is. You don't have professors of education. That's what you need. You need professors of education. Professors of education, you'd reply. Why, we've got graduate schools of education loaded with professors of education. We've even got doctors of education. They write the textbooks. They train the teachers. We've got plenty of those. No problem. Big supply. Well, they'd still be puzzled. You've got free public schools. You've got compulsory school attendance. You've got certified teachers. You've got professors of education. What could be the problem? Then he'd think further. He'd say, I know what you're lacking. You're not doing enough research in education. That's it. You're not doing enough research. Research, you'd reply. Why, our Department of Education, our National Institute of Education, our foundations, our graduate schools of education, our education labs are doing more research on education than has ever been done in the history of the world. We pump millions and millions of dollars into educational research every year. We've got thousands of scholars doing nothing but educational research on all sorts of government grants, foundation grants, and we do more research on the teaching of reading than any other subject. How do you like that? Well, he'd really be puzzled. He'd say, well, you've got free public schools, compulsory school attendance, certified teachers, professors of education, educational research. I know what your problem is. You're not spending enough money. That's your problem. And you'd look at him, money? Why, this nation spends more money on education than any nation in the history of the human race. As a matter of fact, right here in California, at least one half of the entire state budget goes to pay for education. In some states, as much as 75% of that state budget is devoted to education. We spend billions on education in this country. Well, he'd really be puzzled. He'd say, so you've got free public schools, you've got compulsory school attendance, you've got certified teachers, you've got professors of education, you've got research, you're spending all this money. What could be the problem? And then you'd look at him with a rather sad face and you'd say, well, see, the problem is that every year in America, about 1 million children are born with learning defects. You see, we have a lot of defective children in this country who can't learn to read. And so he'd say, oh, it's a medical problem, not an educational one. Yes, I'm afraid so. We just have all these defective children. Terrible situation. And so he'd walk away very sadly. Well, now what you might think is something that's not being said. Do you know that is the current wisdom? That's the current wisdom of the educators. You ask them what the problem is, they'll tell you it's the children. There's something wrong with American children. Tonight on the television program, They were discussing all about illiteracy, and then one of the anchormen asked her, what's causing all this illiteracy? And you know what the lady said? She said, well, it's the children are getting all this, they have this condition called dyslexia. You see, there's something wrong with the children in America. And that was dismissed like that, and the anchorman then said, oh, I see, and then went on to some other subject. But to prove to you how that is the ideas that are taking hold of America, that it's the children's fault, that they are defective. The other day when traveling on a Delta airliner, I picked up a copy of their magazine. You know, every airline has a magazine, and this one is called Sky Magazine. It's a nice, thick magazine, and you know, with very, very well done. It's read by thousands of executives who fly on Delta Airlines, airplanes. And the lead article in the October issue was one dealing with the reading problem, was called Dealing with Dyslexia. You see, dyslexia is the medical term for reading problem. And I thought, well, I'd better read this because this is my field. I've been studying this whole subject for 20 years, more than 20 years, and I figured maybe this man has finally found the truth. I want to find out what he says. Well, this is what he says about dyslexia. He says, dyslexia is one of the most misunderstood, misdiagnosed, and underestimated of the learning language disorders. You see, it's a really mysterious disease. And then he describes dyslexia as a disorder manifested by difficulty in learning to read despite conventional instruction, adequate intelligence, and socio-cultural opportunity. See, in other words, you can be perfectly intelligent, you can even be rich, and still be dyslexic, you see. Well, it turns out that this particular author found a lady by the name of Elizabeth Fleming. Now, Elizabeth Fleming is a woman who has had 5 dyslexic children. So that makes her an authority on dyslexia, doesn't it? As a matter of fact, she has called her family the perfect dyslexia lab. Now, naturally, if you have 5 dyslexic children, you're going to write a book about it, right? And that's what Mrs. Fleming has done. She's written a book on the subject. And this is what she writes in her book about dyslexia. She says, I feel that dyslexia is a progressive hereditary trait, one that is increasing in the human population. More and more dyslexics are diagnosed every year. In the United States, an estimated 10% of the children entering kindergarten are being diagnosed dyslexic. It is a phenomenon that has been identified in more than 20 countries. In these days of growing anxiety that modern man may not be able to keep up with the information explosion and technological advances made during this century, I suggest that man need not fear. Perhaps hereditary dyslexics are the new breed of man, an evolutionary species that does not live in a world of up, down, right, left, but rather in the multidimensional or non-dimensional world of space. And then Mrs. Fleming asks, can this be called the age of dyslexia? Well, you can see how far this lunacy can go. Isn't that amazing? Now it's a new evolutionary species. Isn't that interesting? I thought that when they teach you evolution, they say, according to evolution, things are supposed to get better and better. They're supposed to improve. How come the kids are getting dumber and dumber? What is that, devolution, not evolution? Very strange idea, but you could see how, you know, these people are just going way out in grasping at any kind of idea. Incidentally, if this is the age of dyslexia, how are we going to handle the age of information? If people are not going to be able to read, how are we going to handle the so-called age of information that the book Megatrend says that we are now entering, the age of information? Well, you know, this particular article what Mrs. Fleming says, that's all complete hogwash, total nonsense. You see, we know why we have a reading problem. We know what causes the reading problem. We've known it for over 30 years. Do you know we've known it for over 30 years? You know what, when we found out? We found out in 1955 when a man by the name of Dr. Rudolf Flesch wrote a very famous book entitled Why Johnny Can't Read. I'm sure that many of you have heard of that book. You remember that book, Why Johnny Can't Read? Would you believe it? It was published in 1955, over 30 years ago, and Dr. Flesch told us exactly why children were having problems learning to read. He said there was nothing wrong with the children. He says what's wrong is the way the teachers, the way the schools are teaching children to read. They're teaching children to read English as if it were Chinese. And this is what he said. He said, the teaching of reading all over the United States, in all the schools, in all the textbooks, is totally wrong and flies in the face of all logic and common sense. And then he explained, he said that the teaching of reading had been changed by the professors of education in American schools. In the early 1930s, what they did, they threw out the alphabetic phonics method of teaching reading, which is the proper way you teach an alphabetic writing system, and they put a new method in the schools. The new method was called the look-say, or whole word, or sight word method, in which you are taught to read English as if it were an ideographic writing system, that is, as if each little word were a picture, as if it were like Chinese. And he said, that's the reason why children are having problems learning to read. You can't learn to read that way. So he explained it to us. Now, perhaps there are some people who don't know the difference between phonics and the look-say method. Let me explain to you. First of all, let me explain the difference between a simple illiterate and a functional illiterate. A simple illiterate is someone who never went to school and never learned to read. There are lots of people like that. My mother was a simple illiterate. She came from Europe. She was never taught. She never went to school in Europe, never learned to read. So she was an illiterate because of lack of education. And I know what it's like to live with an illiterate. I know what their lives are like. It's not very happy situation to be in. But she was a very intelligent woman, but she just never went to school. That's a simple illiterate. A functional illiterate is somebody who spends from as many as 8 to 10 to 12 years in school and comes out with a reading ability so low that they are classified functionally illiterate. That is, they cannot use the written language. Totally inadequate ability. The man who was on television tonight, he was a functional illiterate because he had gone to school and he'd come out without an ability to read. Simple illiteracy is very cheap. It doesn't cost the taxpayer anything because, you don't go to school, you're not taking up any taxes, you're not paying for an education. But functional literacy is very expensive. You see, America, to create a functional illiterate, you've got to have that youngster in school for many years. And American schools have become American public schools now specialize in producing functional illiteracy.
Right.
It is one of the highest arts of American education to produce a true functional illiterate. It's not easy keeping a person in school for 12 years and making sure he doesn't learn to read. It takes a lot of effort. Very expensive, you know. And then when these kids drop out, you see all of these programs, get the dropouts back into school. You know, they've already ruined them, but they want them back to ruin them some more, you see.
Amen.
But now, the difference between phonics and look-say. Ours is an alphabetic writing system. What does that mean? That means that we use an alphabet. What is an alphabet? An alphabet is a set of letters or symbols, graphic symbols, we call them letters, that stand for the irreducible speech sounds of the language. Every alphabet is the same in that respect. Every alphabet stands for the speech sounds of its language. For example, if you wanted to learn Russian, you'd have to learn the Russian letters and the sounds that they stand for. And that's how you would begin to learn to read Russian. The same with Hebrew. When I went to Hebrew school as a boy, being trained for confirmation, I had to learn to read Hebrew because in the prayer books, the prayers are printed in Hebrew. So you have to read them in Hebrew, even though you may not understand them. And you can learn to read Hebrew without understanding it. You're taught the letters, the sounds, and you can read it. You may not understand what the words say, but you can read them because you know the sounds that the letters stand for. So ours is an alphabetic writing system. Our letters stand for sounds. They're not there for decoration. They're there, they have meaning. They stand for sounds. Now the alphabet was invented about 2,000 years BC. Now what kind of writing did men use before the alphabet was invented? Well, the earliest form of writing was pictography. Pictographs. What are pictographs? Well, what did the cavemen do? They drew pictures on their walls. They were pictures of hunting scenes or whatever. But you didn't have to go to school to recognize that that was a hunting scene. An animal looked like an animal, a human being looked like a human being, a bow and arrow looked like a bow and arrow. Language was used to interpret the story. Maybe there was a story behind it. But the symbols were pictures, so we call that pictography. Now, as civilization became more complex, the scribes had to begin to draw pictures of things and ideas and actions that did not lend themselves to depiction. For example, how would you draw a picture of to know, or to start, or to begin, or to feel? Who, or whom, or despite, or process, or expect. How do you draw a picture of expect? You can't. So what they do is they draw a little picture and they say, this stands for expect. It doesn't look like expect, but somebody's got to tell you that stands for expect. And so that became what is known as ideographs. An ideograph is a symbol that does not look like what it represents. Now, Egyptian hieroglyphics were ideographs. Present-day Chinese is an ideographic writing system. And they had to draw thousands and thousands of those little pictures that did not look like anything they represented. How did you learn to read such a system? It was very difficult. Somebody had to sit with you, a scribe, and you had to be taught over many years how to recognize all of these different symbols. And of course, the Chinese use them today. The Chinese have 50,000 of those little symbols that they use. You have to memorize at least 5,000 of them before you can read a Chinese newspaper. Not too long ago, when the UN was celebrating its 40th anniversary, the cameras, the TV interviewers went behind the scenes to interview some of the translators. And the camera stopped in front of a Chinese translator later working at a Chinese typewriter. How many keys do you think a Chinese typewriter has? 1,000 keys. 1,000 keys on a Chinese typewriter. So, and incidentally, we use ideographs today, and we also use pictographs. They're making a great comeback. For example, you go to any international airport, and they're all over the airports, they're in buses, you see them on road signs, you know, you want to go to the restroom, and you have to look for the little picture of, if you're male, the one in pants, and the other one in skirts. But since these days many women wear pants, they may go into the wrong room. So it's usually what they usually do is they'll have the little picture, but they'll also have men and women or ladies and gentlemen with it. But in some airports they don't. They just have the little pictures, and you've got to know where you're going. They use them on road signs. You've seen these road signs, like a truck swerving or skidding. That means wet surface, be careful. In North Carolina the other day, I saw one that I'd never seen before. It was a circle with a question mark in it. There we are, driving down the road, there's a road sign with a circle with a question mark. I figured it was asking, do you know where you're going? But then I noticed there was a little arrow underneath it pointing to the left. And I quickly looked to the left to see what in blazes it stood for. And there it was, information booth for tourists. Information. See, now you know what that sign means if you see it anywhere. Circle with a question mark means information. So that's what that means. Now they're using it, as I said, a lot in airports. But usually they accompany it with alphabetic writing because they realize that sometimes those pictures are not terribly clear. People don't immediately understand what they mean, and so they have to clarify them. But I was at one airport where there was no alphabetic writing used at all in these public signs. That was at Little Rock, Arkansas. I got off the plane and I look at the signs and where's baggage claim? Well, you have to follow the little bag, a picture of a suitcase. And you follow that picture of a suitcase in order to get your bags. And then when I was being brought back to the airport, they don't have any signs saying arrivals and departures. What they have is a sign showing an airplane going up. So you gotta think fast. Is that arrivals or departures? I guess that's when you're departing, you go up, that's right. And for arrivals, they had a picture of an airplane going this way, down. You see, now it doesn't mean that's where they crash, that means that's where they arrive, but that's the trend, you see. They want Americans to get used to, you see, there are so many illiterates now in America, they want us to get used to reading pictures. Well, now, at about 2,000 years before the birth of Christ, somebody made an astonishing discovery. Somebody discovered that all of human language, everything we say, is composed of a very small number of irreducible speech sounds. And he said, instead of using this cumbersome writing system whereby you've got to memorize thousands and thousands of little squigglies and pictures that don't look like anything, why not create a set of symbols to stand for the speech sounds of the language, and then we will be able to transcribe all of the spoken language into written form, and then one will be able very easily to translate it back into spoken form. And so the first alphabet was invented. Now, when I say that all of human language is composed of a very small number of speech sounds, I mean a small number. For example, the English language has a vocabulary approaching a million words. How many irreducible speech sounds do you think there are in the English language? I always ask this question of an audience because this is the kind of information that every individual who ever went to school should have been given in kindergarten and first grade. And this is the kind of information that most Americans just don't have. They should have had it. But are there any volunteers? How many?
Five. A-E-I-O-U.
No. Come on, there are more than five. How many?
Seven.
No.
44.
Well, you were at my speech. There are only 44 sounds in the entire English language. And we use those 44 sounds in endless combinations to make up our thousands and thousands of words, and we're inventing new words every day, you know that. 44 sounds. Well, you might say, well, how come we use a 26-letter alphabet? Well, you see, what happened was when the Romans conquered the British Isles, they imposed their Latin alphabet on the people who lived there, on the Anglo-Saxon speaking people. I don't know what they were speaking in those days. I guess you would call it Anglo-Saxon. That's why we use the Latin alphabet, an alphabet of 26 letters to stand for 44 sounds. Well, it creates some problems, not terribly difficult problems. For example, some of the letters have to stand for more than one sound, and you have to know when they stand for this sound or that sound. For example, the letter A stands for at least four sounds. It stands for A, as in apron. It stands for A, short A, as in cat. It stands for A, as in father. And it stands for O, as in all or fall. You see. So there are four sounds that one letter stands for. How do you know when that letter stands for that sound? We know it through the spelling form. You see, the English language has many different spelling forms, and that's how you learn what these letters mean. Also, sometimes we spell the same sound in different ways. Take the sound long A. It is spelled A as in apron. It is spelled A-I, as in paid. It is spelled E-I, as in rain, R-E-I-N, or vein, V-E-I-N-E-I. You see, so there are many different ways in which we spell the same sound. So it makes spelling a little difficult for our youngsters. But they're not insurmountable problems. We've created the world's greatest literature with our English alphabetic system. The plays of Shakespeare, the philosophical works of John Locke, the poetry of Milton, the King James Version of the Bible is written in alphabetic English. In fact, very soon after the alphabet was invented, something very important occurred, something very important to man's spiritual development. The scripture began to appear. You see, we had to wait until the alphabet was invented before God's word could be put on paper. See, how does God communicate with us? Through the word. He doesn't send us little pictures. He doesn't send us comic books, does he? As a matter of fact, he doesn't particularly care for the image, does he? If you read the Ten Commandments. You know. He communicates with us through the Word, and we communicate back through the Word, through prayer. Because what does it say in the Bible? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So we equate the Word with God, because after all, the Word is very powerful when it comes to God. How did God create the universe? He didn't hire a contractor. He said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And then, of course, when we pray, our prayers certainly have power. We know that. You know, human beings are the only species that speak. We're the only ones who use language. Why is that? Because God made us in His image. You see, the ability to speak. That's why we speak, because God wants to be able to communicate with us. He spoke to Adam in the Garden of Eden. You know, He had conversations with him. Communication between man and God is through the Word. And the invention of the alphabet was so crucial because for the first time, mankind had God's Word on paper so that he could have God's law, God's guidance right there. Very important, crucial to our spiritual development. Well, of course, the alphabet swept away the Egyptian hieroglyphics. Now, how did you teach a child the alphabet? It was very simple. You taught him the letters of the alphabet to recognize them. If you were Greek, alpha, beta, gamma, that sort of thing. If you were Hebrew, aleph, beth. In English, A, B, C, etc. And then you taught the child the letter, the sounds that the letters stood for. And how did you do that? And how do you do it today? You teach the sounds in isolation. You say that you teach a child that the letter B stands for B, or the letter M stands for M. That's the meaning of those letters. That's what they stand for. That's what they symbolize. And then you put the letters together with vowels so that the child then will drill these sounds in columns, reading, for example, bay, be, bi, bo, boo, ba, be, bi, ba, ba, may, me, my, mo, moo. That's the way children were taught to read in America for years and years and years. And they learned to read very well. You know why? Because they learned to associate the letters with the sounds. So that by the time, you know, they were at the end of the first grade, they could practically read anything.
That's right.
It's not difficult. Very simple, simple process. Everybody can learn to read that way. No problem at all. I've been teaching a severely retarded youngster to read that way. He has problems. His speech is garbled, but he's learned. It's the only way you can teach a child to read, anyone to read. In any case, that's the method that was used to teach in this country until the 1930s, when the professors of education decided to change things. They decided to teach children to read English as if it were an ideographic writing system, like Chinese, not an alphabetic system. They said, we will not teach the children the sounds of the letters. We will teach children to look at each word as if it were a little picture. Well, when you, and we will teach the child a sight vocabulary. You know what a sight vocabulary is? That is teaching children words without their knowing the sounds of the letters. They may not even know, not even have been taught the ABC. But they simply flash a whole word, maybe with a picture, and then they repeat it over and over again, and they expect the child to see a picture. For example, they expect that when the child sees the word H-O-R-S-E, he's supposed to see something galloping there. Sees the word horse, he doesn't know the letters, he doesn't know what the letters stand for. He's supposed to see a little picture of a horse. But let's face it, H-O-R-S-E does not look like a horse. So how do children remember these words? How do they manage to remember whole words without knowing the letters? Any way they can. There isn't a single professor of education in America that can tell you how children remember sight words. Some children can read them upside down. Some professors say that when a child sees the word H-O-R-S-E, and if he says pony, that's correct. Because the child is seeing the picture, he's seeing something galloping. That's correct. But you can see that that produces very inaccurate readers. Very inaccurate readers. If you don't know the difference between a horse and a pony, you're in big trouble. As a matter of fact, the man who created the Dick and Jane books, which are the look-say reading books, William Scott Gray, at the age of 75, died accidentally from falling off a horse. Maybe he thought he was on a pony. Very dangerous business. In any case, the look-say method does not create accurate readers. Why? Because the child is looking for the little picture. And it creates terrible spellers. You know why? Because the letters, the sequence of the letters is not important to a child who's looking at a picture. After all, when you look at a picture, do you look at it from left to right? Do you look at it from right to left? You look at it any way you can, any way you want to. And so the sequence of letters does not mean very much to the youngster, but to a phonics-trained youngster, the sequence of the letters means everything, because the sequence follows the same sequence in which the sounds are uttered. You see how important? That's why a phonics reader becomes usually a good speller. But in any case, you might ask, why would the professors of America put such a stupid method of teaching reading in the schools of this country? Why would they subject American children to a method that produces inaccurate readers who can't spell. Why would they do such a horrible thing like that? Well, I asked that question when I started looking into this over 20 years ago, way back when in the 1963. Rudolf Flesch thought that they did it because they were stupid. And I believed that for a long time. I said, they must have been very stupid men to have done this. Then I thought to myself, gee, but they're the very top educators in America. They're the top professors. They're giving out PhDs to everyone else. They're not stupid men. They're not stupid at all. And then I thought further, I said, it must be greed, because these men were writing the textbooks, and you see these looks say textbooks were very costly, and you had to use a lot of them. You see, when you teach a child to read by phonics, all you need is a little book in the first grade. Sometimes you don't even need a book. You can do it with a chalk and a chalkboard. But usually, to teach a child to read by phonics, all you need is a little book in the first grade. Then after that, you can read anything. Anything that you want. Anything of interest. But when you use the look-say method, you lock the child in a sight vocabulary at the very beginning. And everything builds on that same sight vocabulary, so that you've got to buy a whole set of books beginning with the first grade and going up right through to the sixth grade. So it's a much more expensive proposition. The publishers love it because instead of having to sell one book, they sell 12 books, each from one each semester. 12 books with all kinds of cards and easels and all sorts of paraphernalia. They made millions of dollars on this. And I thought, well, these professors are very smart and very greedy, making lots of money. But then I began to do research on my book for the NEA, and I said to myself, I'm gonna get to the bottom of this thing. This whole thing smells so fishy. Because you see, after Rudolf Flesch wrote his book in 1955 and explained what was wrong, nothing changed. The schools went on doing what they were doing. So I said, I'm going to get to the bottom of this. And so I got to the very beginning, and I found out that all of this was started by a group of educators who were called the progressives. Now, who were these men? These were a new breed of educator that had come on the scene around the turn of the century. They were men who had rejected Christianity. They rejected the religion of their own families and ancestors, because they all came from good Christian homes. Some of them were even the sons of ministers. They believed that evolution was truth, that religion was superstitious nonsense, that science could explain everything. So they believed in evolution. They were atheists. And then they were also, they believed in the new psychology, the new experimental psychology that was being developed in the laboratories of Professor Wilhelm Wundt in Germany, whereby he was beginning to look at human beings as we do animals. Because you see, they believed that in evolution, and they believe that simply man is simply a higher animal, and so you could study man the way you study animals. And in fact, you can study man's mind as you do animals, because what was man's mind? Simply a development of animal mind. And so these professors did all of their experiments with animals. For example, Edward L. Thorndike thought that he could learn a lot about how children learn by studying chickens. So he studied chickens, and he was the one who devised this new stimulus response technique of teaching that was put in all of the schools of America. And Pavlov, as you know, studied dogs, conditioning, to condition dogs. You've heard of the Pavlov dogs, I'm sure. The salivating dog with the ringing of the bell, the food. What he would do is you give the dog food, and you ring a bell at the same time, and the dog salivates because he's getting the food. After a while, all you do is have to ring the bell, and the dog salivates before, without the food. That's what is known as conditioning, the techniques of conditioning. John B. Watson did his experiments with rats, and of course B.F. Skinner has continued to do experiments with rats. B.F. Skinner doesn't think that there's much of a difference between rats and human beings. Now, there may not be much of a difference between B.F. Skinner and a rat.
Yeah.
But I think there's a considerable difference between human beings and rats. Also, these men were socialists. Now, why were they socialists? Well, being an atheist does not necessarily make you a socialist. Believing in evolution does not necessarily make you a socialist. But why were they socialists? Well, these particular men, when they gave up their belief in Christianity and in the Bible, they had to come up for a new explanation of the origin, the source of evil. You see, what does the Bible tell us? The Bible tells us that the source of evil is man himself. Man is a sinner. He fell from grace in the Garden of Eden. He rebelled against God. And since then, he has been basically playing footsie with Satan, you see. And the Bible tells us that the only way that we can save ourselves from our own evil, inner evil, our own innate depravity, which is the term that John Calvin used, is by obeying God's law, obedience to God, and of course, by being saved. That's the only way we can deal with our evil. That's the only way that man has of controlling his own evil impulses, is to believe in God, obey God, and seek salvation. That's the only way. Well, these particular men rejected all of that. They said, Christ was not divine. He was just a man like everyone else. The Bible is a mythology, fairy tale. But yet they had to come up with a new theory of evil, because if they reject the biblical explanation, why does man do the horrible things he did? John Calvin said that man was, John Calvin coined the phrase, total depravity. He would not have been surprised by an Adolf Hitler. He would not have been surprised by a Stalin. See, today we say, oh, Hitler was inhuman, and Stalin was inhuman, and these people act like animals. No, animals are much kinder than that. I've never seen animals abort 18 million of their own children.
Right.
You see, dogs don't do that. Have you ever seen how a dog treats its own puppies? Man is man, you see, and man is capable of committing evil and depravity to an extent which all you have to do is turn on your television set to get an idea of what man is capable of. And we certainly have lived it. We've certainly seen enough in the 20th century to convince ourselves that man is capable of any evil you can imagine. If you can imagine it, man will do it. I mean, and evil people don't look, you know, don't have horns. They don't look crazed. 18 million unborn children have been murdered in this country by women who look perfectly normal.
Yeah.
You know, doctors perform those murders every day in America, and after they've done their day's work, they get into their Mercedes and have dinner in a beautiful restaurant. You may be sitting next to one of them someday. You can't tell them. You can't tell that that's evil, that man is evil. Well, so these psychologists, these professors, had to come up with an explanation of evil. Why do men do the horrible things they do? Well, they said it's because of ignorance, poverty and social injustice. You've heard that line before. Ignorance. Well, we'll educate everyone, we'll get rid of ignorance. Ignorance will get rid of poverty, and of course, poverty will get rid of social injustice. And then they decided, what is the major cause of social injustice? They said it's that evil, capitalist, private property, individualistic social system that's causing it. They said, what we've got to do if we want to create a good society, a society of wonderful people who only do good, we've got to get rid of that horrible economic system that makes men do all these horrible things, because capitalism produces these, and the religions produce these individualists, you know, these people who believe in private property, these greedy, selfish people. And so they said, we are going to change America. They had this messianic mission. We're going to change America. Well, now they realize that the American people were not about to overthrow their way of life. Americans love their way of life. Our free enterprise system has given us the highest standard of living in the world. I mean, why should Americans want to do away with an economic system that has been so successful? Americans don't want to give up their private property, their homes. Americans don't want to give up their individualism, because as individuals, they have a personal relationship with God. That's what makes them individuals, their own personal relationship with God. That's how individualism comes about. And so the professors thought, well, what we will have to do is educate the young, get them young enough, and then give them a new kind of education that will turn them into little socialists, so that we will be able to change America from a free enterprise, individualistic, believing nation into a socialist, collectivist, atheist nation. Says we'll work on the children. Well, of course, that meant that they had to change the curriculum in the schools, because the curriculum that existed then was sustaining the very system that they loathed and hated and said had to be done away with. And so John Dewey, who was the chief honcho among these professors, got to work in his laboratory school at the University of Chicago, and after 2 years he came up with a master plan whereby the curriculum in the American public school would be revolutionized, radically changed, to produce an entirely different kind of person. And he wrote it all in a book entitled School and Society. It's a very short book, you could read it in one sitting, which was published around the turn of the century. And that book, incidentally, is required reading by every teacher who goes to a teacher's college today. You must read that book. Now, what was in John Dewey's book? What was his curriculum? What did he say had to be done? He said, what we've got to do is de-emphasize the literacy skills, the language skills, the academic skills. And we've got to switch the emphasis over to the social skills, to social studies, to activities, to behavior, to values. He says, we've got to put the emphasis there. De-emphasize literacy. Now, why did they want to de-emphasize literacy? Because they considered high literacy to be an obstacle to socialism. Why? Because high literacy produced that independent intelligence, that individual who could stand on his own 2 feet, who could think for himself and didn't have to take instructions from an elite at the top. You see, in a socialist society, you have an elite at the top that rules over everybody else. And so they want everybody to be dumber than they are. They want the people to be manipulable. They want to be able to manipulate you like puppets. And if you don't know how to read, you're at their mercy. And so they said, in as many words, we've got to dumb down the American people. Also, high literacy produced people who could read the Bible. And if you want to get this nation, if you want to turn this nation into an atheist nation, you've got to get people who can't read the Word of God. And so Here they had this plan. They said, we've got to give the impression to the American people that we're educating their children while at the same time dumbing them down. How are we going to do this? Well, now, these were the world's top psychologists. As I explained, they had done their experiments with animals. They were the top educators in America. You could not get any higher than them. They were giving out the PhDs to everyone. They were training all the other teachers. How are they going to do this? They said, we have a wonderful idea. We will change the way we teach reading. We'll throw out the method of teaching that creates high literacy, and we will substitute a new method that creates low literacy. We'll have children learn to read English as if it were Chinese. Now, it took until 1930 before the books were ready to be put in the schools. You see, the professors were dealing with all these ideas in the first decade of the century. And they were experimenting here and there. Did they know that their method would create reading disability? You bet they did. Because the method was being tried in isolated areas, they had more than enough evidence that there would be reading disability. As a matter of fact, on the eve of their putting all of the books in the schools, the new books, they were warned. They were warned by a medical doctor that their new method would create problems. Who warned them? Dr. Samuel T. Orton of Iowa State University, a neuropathologist. Now, Dr. Orton had been dealing with youngsters with reading problems. They were coming to him because they were trying the new method out in Iowa. And children were coming to him with all sorts of problems. And he found out that the reason why they were having these problems was because of this new teaching method. And so he felt that it was important to warn the professors that this method could cause problems. And he wrote an article that was published in the February 1929 issue of the Journal of Educational Psychology. This is the title of the article. The sight reading method of teaching reading as a source of reading disability. He knew it would cause reading disability. And this is what Dr. Orton wrote. He said, I wish to emphasize at the beginning that the strictures which I have to offer here do not apply to the use of the sight method of teaching reading as a whole, but only to its effects on a restricted group of children for whom, as I think we can show, this technique is not only not adapted, but often proves an actual obstacle to reading progress. And moreover, I believe that this group is one of considerable size. Well, you see, at that time he was dealing with a very small sample. But that considerable size today is one-third of the student population. I had that confirmed to me the other day when I was visiting a school in Selma, California, an elementary school, where they are now using an alphabetic phonics method of teaching, a strong phonics method. And the principal of that school is Peggy Adams. Now, when she was graduated from, I think it was Fresno State Teachers College, one of those colleges, she was told by her professors and by other teachers to expect that one-third of the children would not learn to read. She was told that was normal, that was routine, and that's the way things were. One-third of the children were not going to learn to read. She was told that. She told that to me the other day when I visited her. And then she also told me, she said, and she was told that the second third would get by. Only one-third would develop a proficiency in reading. Only one-third out of that entire class. Now, she taught that way for a number of years and said to herself, there must be a better way. And so in going through a catalog, she found this intensive phonics method of teaching reading, and she sent away for it. It's the method that's being promoted by the CBN, CBN University Sing, Spell, Read, and Write program. And so she's used it for the last 5 years, and she's had little migrant workers' children who learn to read very well. No problem. That's an isolated little school. And now the Selma School District is a tiny town as cities go in California. But you know, the educators have a way of isolating success. They don't let the people in Los Angeles hear about it. Or the people in San Francisco, or in Stockton, you see. I asked her, I said, and she's a wonderful woman, not a feisty person. I asked her, I said, does Dr. Honig know what you're doing? She says, I don't know if he does or not. I said, well, have you heard from him at all? She says, I've gotten one call from Sacramento in 5 years. But in any case, we know that it's at least one-third of the student population. Let me continue what Dr. Orton said. He said, and moreover, and because here, faulty teaching methods may not only prevent the acquisition of academic education by children of average capacity, but may also give rise to far-reaching damage to their emotional life. He already knew in 1929 that this was having a terrible effect on the children's emotional life, not being able to learn to read. 1929. Well, what did the professors do? You might think, well, maybe they didn't read the article. Well, they had to because it was published in their own journal. There was only one journal of educational psychologists, psychology, and the educational psychologists were the ones who were editing that. They had to read it because the very men who were creating these new look-say textbooks were the editors of this publication. So why did they publish it? I think they published it because it confirmed to them what they wanted to know, that this new method would indeed cause reading disability on a large scale. And so they proceeded to put the books in the schools the very next year. The Dick and Jane books, the Gates readers. Almost overnight, school district after school district just threw out alphabetic phonics and adopted the new look-say textbooks. Now you might ask, why did it take so long? Why did they have to wait until 1930? Well, it took that long for them to have all of their superintendents in place. You see, the graduate schools of education were training the new superintendents and telling them how socialism was the wave of the future and how we've got to change American education to prepare American children for the new future, socialism. And so when the professors, you know, pressed the button, the superintendents were ready to do their jobs and the books were put in the schools. Now, if a pharmaceutical firm on the eve of introducing a new drug had been warned by a medical doctor that that drug would cause serious problems, do you think that pharmaceutical firm would be stupid enough to put that drug on the market? They'd be sued out of business. But yet these professors did it. You know why? Because this article by Dr. Orton was published in their publication and nobody else read it. The parents didn't read it. The parents didn't know what was going on. But it didn't take very long before dyslexia became a household word in America. As a matter of fact, by 1944, Life magazine published a leading article on the reading problem. 1944 already, America knew it had a reading problem. This is what Life magazine wrote in April 1944. Millions of children in the U.S. suffer from dyslexia, which is the medical term for reading difficulties. It is responsible for about 70% of the school failures in the 6 to 12-year-old age group and handicaps about 15% of all grade school children. Dyslexia may stem from a variety of physical ailments or combination of them. You see, the editors obviously went to the professors and said, pray tell, what is causing all of these problems? And these are the answers the professors gave them. Glandular imbalance, heart disease, eye or ear trouble, or from a deep-seated psychological disturbance that blocks a child's ability to learn. You see, they already knew that something was blocking the children's ability to learn, but that nobody knew why, and the professors certainly were not going to tell them. The article then described the treatment given a young girl afflicted with dyslexia. Here was the treatment. Thyroid treatments. Removal of tonsils and adenoids. Exercises to strengthen her eye muscles. See, they put little weights on her eyelids so that she could develop bulging muscles on her eyes. That was going to improve her reading. Nowhere did they recommend teaching her the alphabet. That would have been the simple thing to do. Ask the young girl if she knew the letters of the alphabet. But you know, you ask yourself, didn't these editors, when they read this, didn't they say to themselves, well, if the reading problem is being caused by heart disease, why are they removing her adenoids? You know, you would, a little thought. But no, everybody was so completely fooled, so completely deceived by these professors. And you could just imagine these professors laughing all the way to the bank. I mean, and by then they were carrying satchels of royalties money to the banks. They were making so much money from these books. Here they were crippling children by the millions and becoming millionaires in the process. What evil you talk about, evil.
Right.
There you had it. Well, we had to wait until 1955, when Rudolf Flesch blew the whistle. And for the first time, he told the American people, there's nothing wrong with the children, it's the teaching method. And he pointed an accusing finger at those professors. He told the American people what they didn't know, that the method of teaching reading had been changed. And he pointed an accusing finger at the professors, and incidentally, he named all the professors in his book. That book is still available, Why Johnny Can't Read. It's available in paperback. I strongly suggest that you read it. He pointed an accusing finger at the professors, and he said, look, you dummies, don't you know that phonics works better than look-say? Well, of course, the professors knew that. He wasn't telling them anything they didn't know. But they were absolutely enraged by Rudolf Flesch. Why? Because he had made them appear stupid in public. He ridiculed them. They were anything but stupid. So they did something. They decided they would fix him. They turned the entire teaching profession against them. They told the teachers, don't read this man's book. He doesn't know what he's talking about. He is the devil incarnate. Matter of fact, there was an article in Time magazine with the heading, The Devil in the Flesh. They really made him appear horrible. So they turned the entire profession against him. And then they did something very, very clever. They formed the International Reading Association, which has become the largest organization for teaching, for elementary school teachers in the world. And so American teachers are told how to teach reading in the manner that the professors want them to teach it. And that's the way it's been right down to the present. Now you might perhaps not believe that they use animal training techniques in teaching children to read. Well, let me read to you what Professor Walter Dearborn wrote in 1940. Professor Walter Dearborn, educational psychologist from Harvard University. You can't get any higher than that. And he was incidentally a pupil of Thorndike at Teachers College. That's where he's got his PhD. This is what he said about that method of teaching reading. He said, the principle which we have used to explain the acquisition of a sight vocabulary is of course the one suggested by Pavlov's well-known experiments on the conditioned response. This is as it should be. The basic process involved in conditioning and in learning to read is the same. In other words, he's telling us that we teach children to read as if they were dogs. Now, I submit there is a bit of a difference between a child and a dog. Because, you know, when a dog enters the first grade, what does a dog say? Arf, arf, right? And let us assume that Fido is socially promoted right through the 12th grade and is ready for graduation, and he holds out his paw to accept his diploma. And what can Fido say? Arf, arf. In 12 years, he hasn't learned a single word. Isn't that something? You know, the behavioral psychologists are convinced that man's ability to speak is just a further development of the bark, of the chirp, of the meow, of, you know, just animal speech. As a matter of fact, they call human language verbal behavior. So whenever you speak, you're behaving verbally. And the reason why they say that monkeys can't speak is because they've been culturally deprived. So they decided to prove that that was right, and they've had monkeys, little monkeys, live among human families, grow up only among human beings to see if monkeys would learn to speak. Well, what do you know? The monkeys did not learn to speak. These poor professors, they had to just swallow their disappointment. But there's a big difference between a dog and a child. You see, the dog comes to school and says, arf, arf, but a child comes to school with a speaking vocabulary between 5,000 and 35,000 words. You believe a little six-year-old enters the first grade speaking that many words? You see, that child begins teaching himself to speak his own language almost at birth. I mean, you know, anyone who's brought up an infant knows that they begin to hear and babble. And by the time they're four, they've got a great vocabulary. I had dinner with a four-year-old the other night who was using big words I could not believe. And by the time a child is ready to go to school at age six, that child has taught himself to speak his own language and has developed his auditory and verbal skills to the point where he can rattle off 5,000 words without any problem. Isn't that amazing? That's a very intelligent human being. And that's why children feel so intelligent at the age of five and six. You know how they are. They feel that they know more than the parents do. They are very intelligent. They are very serious learners. Children teach themselves to speak their own language, and they do so in a no-nonsense way. They do it by themselves without the help of Sesame Street.
Amen. That's good.
Without the need of cartoons, without anything, they are serious learners. Now let's suppose our little Johnny has reached six and he's ready to go to school. Now he's bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. He says to himself, I've taught myself to speak my own language from the age of one up through five. Learning to read can't be more difficult than that, can it? But let us assume that our little Johnny is one of that one-third that is not going to be able to learn. Maybe he's great on his verbal and auditory skills, but his visual skills are not too hot. He does not have a photographic memory. You know, some people have a photographic memory. They can look at anything and remember it. But a lot of us don't. And so let us assume that little Johnny is now ready to go to school. Mother sends him off and he's happy. He's going to learn to read. He enters the first grade, and this is what he's given to read. Dick. Look, Jane. Look, look, see Dick, see C, O C, see Dick, O C Dick, O O O, funny, funny Dick. This poor child sits there. He says to himself, either I'm crazy or she's crazy.
Right.
I mean, this is not the way people talk. And he should know. He's taught himself to speak his own language. He's been talking a blue streak now for a couple of years. He knows that's not how people talk. He says, gee, this school is a weird place. But mother says I must stay here and I must behave myself. do well, I'll do the best I can. But at the end of the year, Johnny is not doing well. Matter of fact, he's doing very badly. So mother is called to school and told, Mrs. Jones, Johnny has a reading problem. And now Johnny doesn't quite feel as smart as he thought he was. Matter of fact, he's beginning to feel that maybe he's dumb. And mother has told Mrs. Jones, Johnny will have to stay back a year. So Johnny stays back, and at the end of the second year, he isn't doing much better. Matter of fact, he's even doing worse. And so mother is called to school again and told Mrs. Jones, Johnny has a learning disability. Johnny is dyslexic. We'll have to put him in special ed. And then, of course, mother is frantic. She says, have I given birth to a defective child? Is there something wrong with Johnny? And she goes to doctors, psychiatrists, psychologists. He's tested, you know, and it's put on computers, and he's tested here and tested there. The poor youngster is just over-tested. And by the end of the third year, poor Johnny, he's fit to be tied. He's swinging from the rafters. And so mother is called to school again and told, Mrs. Jones, Johnny may have minimal brain damage. You see. And if Johnny is to remain in school, he'll have to take medication. Back to the psychologists and the doctors, and they prescribe Ritalin. That's the popular drug that is now used to take children who have become hyperactive because they can't learn and to turn them into little zombies. So at the end of the third grade, Johnny has been turned into a little zombie and he's destined for a life as a functional illiterate. Now here was a youngster who came into the school at the very learning able. If you can teach yourself to speak your own language, you're very learning able, are you not? And no child is permitted to enter school unless he can talk. So obviously, if he's taught himself to speak his own language, he's very learning able. And isn't it interesting that in 2 years he becomes learning disabled? Who's disabled him? The school, the methods. They've disabled him. They have crippled him for life. They've made him handicapped. Do you know the United States government some years back decided that handicapped children should be entitled to a public education, equal public education as normal children. Now when the government, Congress passed this law, they were thinking of such handicapped children as the deaf, the dumb, the blind, the retarded, the crippled. But do you know what group now is the largest in this handicapped program? The learning disabled. These are perfectly normal youngsters. Intelligent, articulate, perfectly normal, who have been made learning disabled by the school system, by the teaching methods, by the psychologists, by the behavioral psychology. I'll give you an idea of the categories in special education. You have speech impaired, mentally retarded, seriously emotionally disturbed, hard of hearing and deaf, orthopedically handicapped, other health impaired, visually handicapped, multi-handicapped, deaf, blind. Learning disabled is the largest now. In 1977, there were 796,000 learning disabled youngsters in the handicap program. In 1984, there were 1,806,000. It's a growing, you might say it's a growth industry. All the other groups have remained somewhat stable, even improving a little. But the learning disabled are skyrocketing. And that's produced by the schools. These are children deliberately crippled by your school system. You are paying for it. You are paying for it. In California alone, There were 370,000 children in the handicap program. Do you know how many of them were learning disabled? 207,000. Almost two-thirds are learning disabled, this artificial condition produced by the schools. What a crime. What an absolute crime. Now you might say, well, all of our teachers can't be criminals. I mean, do they know what they're doing? Well, Peggy Adams found out what she was doing and changed it. There are many teachers in this country who really believe that there's something wrong with the children. All you have to do is go to the schools and talk to them. They sincerely believe that American children, one-third of American children, are defective. They really believe that. Why? Because their professors told them that. And why shouldn't they believe their professors? Their professors have all those credentials and all those degrees. Are those professors lying? Are they deceiving us? I'm afraid they are.
Yeah.
And there are many people who suspect that. Many people realize there's something wrong in a nation that spends so much money on education, has so many schools, and yet this incredible rising rate of illiteracy. It doesn't make sense, you see. We know the answer. All of this is needless. The little Johnnies who are suffering, totally needless, because we know how to teach reading. Marva Collins does it in her school in Chicago. You know Marva Collins, that wonderful black educator who spent 14 years in the public schools of Chicago, became so disgusted and frustrated that she left that school system and created a private school in her own home. And she took black children from the ghetto who were considered uneducable by the public school, and she's turned them into literate human beings. How did she do it? She taught them to read the proper way. Thousands of Christian schools all over America teach children to read. How come, what do the Christian schools know that the public schools don't? I visited a Christian school in Anchorage, Alaska, the Harvester Christian School. It's been in existence for 16 years, and in all that time they haven't had a single dyslexic child. Isn't that interesting how evolution has sort of gone around them? Bypassed them as if they're a tree trunk in the road, you know? We know how to teach reading. It's no big mystery. We're not looking for a cure for cancer or a cure for AIDS. We know how to do it. Why aren't the public schools doing it? Why aren't they using the methods? Because they are on track for that socialist, glorious socialist future. And they intend to drag the American people kicking and screaming into that world socialist government that they want. They don't intend to change anything. I've talked all over the United States. I haven't seen any interest on the part of the NEA, the organized teachers, the organized educators of America, in changing anything. As a matter of fact, they will fight you tooth and nail if you try to mandate intensive phonics in the public schools. You can do that. Dr. Honig can do it tomorrow. All he has to do is mandate the teaching of intensive phonics in the first grade of every public school of California. He can do that. I mean, he got all the textbooks changed and made sure that they got, you know, a good dose of evolution in them. How come he could get that done overnight? And the publishers were very eager to please. Look, they'll print anything you want. You want evolution? We'll give you evolution. It can be done, but they're not doing it. So there we are, you see. That's just one thing that's wrong with the public schools. One thing. You see, a child in an American public school is at risk in four ways. First, they're at risk academically for the reasons that I've just explained to you. You put your child in a public school and that child has a 30% chance of failure. 30% chance of a failure rate. Now, would you fly on an airline with a 30% failure rate? Would you buy an automobile from a manufacturer that produced 30% lemons? But yet we routinely put our children in schools that produce 30% failure, and we think, oh well, you know, perfectly all right, and we're paying for it. So if you put your child in a public school, you don't know if that child is even going to come out being able to read. Do you know that in 1930, the illiteracy rate among urban blacks was 9.2%, which means that over 90% of urban blacks in 1930 were literate. And when you were literate in 1930, you could read anything. And that was at a time when there was terrible racial discrimination, Jim Crow laws, segregated schools, all kinds of obstacles. And yet in 1986, with affirmative action, with civil rights victories, with equal educational opportunity, with billions of federal dollars in the public schools, the illiteracy rate among blacks is now 50%. 50%. Well, what has happened in the interim? The blacks lost the ability to learn to read? No. Marva Collins proves that they haven't. They are being impacted more than any other group in America because their families are falling apart, they get no support at home, and they are at the total mercy of the public education system because their liberal leadership says, we owe everything to public education. Let's stick to the public schools, you know. And the public schools are destroying the blacks in this country.
Yeah.
They're suddenly beginning to realize that something has happened to them. So that's the problem. So academically, children are at risk in the public schools. Then, of course, they are at risk spiritually. Because what do the public schools do? They do everything in their power to undermine the religious faith of the children. You put a Christian child in a public school and they start working right away. Values clarification. Oh, there are no absolute values. Ten Commandments. Nah, that's mythology. You know, thou shalt not steal. Oh, there are times when you must steal. And they'll give you an extreme situation, like your grandmother is dying of cancer, and that horrible druggist has a drug, and if you don't take that drug, steal that drug, your grandmother's going to die. That's the kind of problems they give the kids in the schools. Oh, well, then you'd steal under such circumstances. Or lying, you know. Oh, there are times when you must lie, too. So they destroy the value system. They destroy the Christian value system. And then they tell the children, well, you're the product of evolution. So you came up out of the primordial ooze. There is no God. Life has no meaning. You're an animal. So they again begin to undermine the faith of the children. Then they say, let's play Dungeons and Dragons.
Right.
We don't want to read the Bible. That's not permitted. But Dungeons and Dragons, wow, open the door to magic, wizardry, spells, casting spells, witchcraft, demonism, Satanism. And the kids get sucked into this whole satanic business. Kids are getting into satanic cults, we know that. Committing murders, horrible atrocities all over the country, suicides. Then they teach the kids death education. Have you heard of death education? They take the kids to field trips to cemeteries, funeral parlors. One mother told me that her daughter actually watched the mortician embalm a corpse. Some of the kids try out coffins. One mother told me that her son had to build a model coffin in school. I mean, when I went to school, we built, you know, book racks. Now they build model coffins. The kids write their own obituaries. They write suicide notes. They discuss suicide at length. They discuss how to do it, when to do it, why to do it. And the result has been a suicide rate 6,000 last year. The other week, three high schoolers in a high school in Nebraska committed suicide in 1 week. Three. In Nebraska? Middle America? Conservative Christian Middle America? Well, the parents don't know what's going on in those schools. Death education has been in the schools now since the 70s. And you will read any number of articles about suicide in the schools, and all they'll tell you is that how they're bringing in all these psychologists and psychiatrists to discuss suicide in school. They will never tell you that they're teaching death education. And yet, I believe that death education is responsible for this increase in suicide. In fact, I demand an investigation of death education in the public schools. I wish parents would demand it. An investigation to see if those children who committed suicide were involved in any death education or Dungeons and Dragons. The other day, going through the NEA's book on health education, published in 1981, they had a chapter on death education entitled Death Education Comes of Age. And this is what it said. In the 1980s, the subject of death and dying will become an accepted and essential aspect of the health education curriculum. Journals such as Death Education and Omega can be helpful in keeping up to date on the issues. I didn't even know that such journals existed. Can you imagine subscribing to death education? Getting it in the mail, something to look forward to every month. Oh, the latest issue of death education. Let's see what they're discussing today, you know. Then she says, funeral directors in many communities are also becoming more concerned with their role as educator. That's news to me. Funeral directors becoming educators? Now, the author of this article, Kathleen Middleton, is the author of A Conceptual Approach to Death and Dying Education, A Complete Curriculum for Junior High School. That's the age that they're targeting, the junior high school kids, with this death education, this morbid, suicidal subject matter. So they undermine the child's religious faith, and of course they then put him in a state of despair and hopelessness. Because they tell the child, look, you're an animal, there is no God, life has no meaning, all you have to look forward to is nuclear holocaust. And they drum that into the heads of the students. As a matter of fact, recently a survey was taken of American school children asking them what they feared most. You know what was on top of the list? Nuclear holocaust. Now here we've had nuclear bombs in our arsenal for since 1945. And nobody was afraid of them. All of a sudden, this mass hysteria over a nuclear holocaust. That's what they're doing to the children. That's what they're doing in the schools, undermining their religious faith. Then the child is at risk morally, because who does the child come in contact with in the school? The drug pushers, the drug users, the sexually promiscuous, the sexually precocious, the users of foul language. There are many Christian children who must endure hearing that foul language day in and day out, and they hate it.
That's right.
They wonder why their parents submit them to such, blasphemy that they hear every day, that foul language. And those kids are worse than drunken sailors when it comes to foul language. They have invented words that I never heard before, expressions. Drugs? Well, we know the school, the public school, has become the marketplace for drugs. Why? Because that's where the customers are. If you're a drug pusher and you want more drug users, you're going to go to the school where you can get these youngsters. And the peer pressure to use drugs is very great if you want to fit in with the others. part of the group, part of the crowd. The rock music, of course, helps, doesn't it? You go to a rock concert, you go to some heavy metal, or one of these groups, and you're driven into a frenzy. And of course, that also promotes sexual promiscuity. That's the second big problem the schools have. Sex. How do the schools handle sex? Now that the teenagers, younger, America has the highest rate of teenage pregnancy of any Western nation. More teenage girls get pregnant who go to American schools, high school students. 15-year-old, 14-year-old, 16-year-old getting pregnant. And you know what the solution of the schools is to the problem? Give the kids pills and condoms. That's going to solve the problem. Now, when you give a child pills and condoms, what are you telling that child? Go out and do it. You don't give pills and condoms to a child if you don't want that child to be active. You just say, no.
Amen.
Thou shalt not. It's a sin.
Amen.
But you can't say that in a public school because the word sin is forbidden. That's part of that Christian vocabulary. Can't use such words in the public schools. So they say, let's give the kids pills and condoms. Of course, they may catch AIDS, but, well, you know, c'est la vie. Here we have an epidemic of a disease, of a plague that we just don't even know where it's going to lead to. They are playing with fire. And the only thing our wonderful educators have to offer to solve the, they have no solution to the drug problem, and their solution for the sex problem is pills and condoms and more sex education. As a matter of fact, the other day when I was in Charlotte, North Carolina, there was a front page story about the new sex education curriculum. You see, they're going to start teaching sex in kindergarten now. Isn't it interesting that as the problem gets worse, they keep saying, well, we've got to teach it. First, they said, we've got to teach it in high school. Then the problem began to crop up in the junior highs. They said, well, now we've got to teach it in junior high. Then the problem started creeping up in the junior highs, and I said, we've got to teach it in the elementary schools. Now they're getting down to kindergarten. They want to make sure that the kids know all about sex very early. This is the way they're going to teach sex education in kindergarten in North Carolina. And incidentally, this is the program that they're going to try to push through in every state. Objective. This is in kindergarten. Pupils will be able to identify and discuss the physical characteristics of boys and girls. Suggested learning activities. Discussion using correct terminology for body parts. Charts and games. Games in kindergarten? Sex games? What kind of games? But that's their solution to the problem. And then, of course, there's the physical risk. You know, children these days are assaulted, robbed in schools. You know, their children go to schools with knives, chains, guns. They've got metal detectors in some of the entrances of big city schools. There was an article in National Review not too long ago in December about the physical problems, the risks in the schools. Here are some interesting statistics. Each month, 3 million high school students are victims of crimes in school, including 2.5 million robberies and thefts. 282,000 students are assaulted in school every month. At least 125,000 teachers are threatened with physical violence each month. 1,000 teachers a month are assaulted badly enough to require medical care. 500,000 high school students say they are afraid in school most of the time. Risks of assault and robbery to urban students are greater in school than outside. High school students are subjected to 525,000 attacks, shakedowns, and robberies every month. Well, now when you stop and consider the academic risk, the spiritual risk, the moral risk, the physical risk, how can any parent in his or her right mind put a child in a public school? I mean, you're really playing Russian roulette with that child's life.
Right.
If the child does not come out as a functional illiterate, he's liable to come out a Satanist. Incidentally, the children who are attracted to Dungeons and Dragons are the good readers, because you have to read to play Dungeons and Dragons. It attracts the intelligent kids. The bright kids are drawn into this Satanism. And also they have to have money, so they come from the affluent suburbs, because you need a computer. See, these are computer games, and they're hooked up all over the country. So, if your child is a good reader, he might become a Satanist. If your daughter doesn't become a Satanist, maybe she'll become pregnant. If she doesn't become pregnant, maybe she'll be hit over the head. You never know. Your child may actually become a functional illiterate, an atheist, a pervert, and also be assaulted. That's really stacking it. But you really are playing with your children's lives when you put them in a public school. Are the public schools going to reform themselves? Can they reform themselves? Just try to change the way reading is taught. I've shown you, I've demonstrated how over the years they have resisted every attempt to get back to intensive phonics. Oh, they talk about getting back to basics. They're not getting back to basics. The only basics they're teaching is basic humanism.
That's right.
I've seen many of these reform bills. There's more humanism now than ever before in the schools. And they are accelerating everything. You see, they realize that time is not on their side anymore. So they are accelerating their program to wrap this thing up as fast as they can, to destroy as many children as they can, and to reduce this nation to a bunch of dummies as fast as they can, to dumb us down. Now, the schools cannot reform themselves. They're not going to reform themselves academically. They're not going to reform themselves spiritually. Oh, you think that a minute of silent prayer is going to change anything? What good is a minute of silent prayer if you're going to give 5 hours and 59 minutes to the devil? What kind of a bargain is that? Are the schools going to change morally? They're going to solve the drug problems? The only place you can get kids away from drugs is to put them in a school where drugs are kept out.
Right.
I'm sure that there are some drugs in some Christian schools, but when they find them, those kids are either kicked out, expelled. I've known of cases where that's happened. It's not the usual thing. But the only solution for parents of this country is to take their children out of the public schools and put them in private schools, homeschools, or Christian schools. That's if they want to save their children from the horrors that can possibly occur to them in the public schools. That's the only choice they have, especially Christians. I cannot understand how a Christian can put a child in an atheist school.
Right.
It doesn't make sense, does it? You see, the humanists only want two things from the Christians of America. They don't want your complaints. They don't want your suggestions. They don't want your meddling in their business. What they want are your children and your money. And the sad thing is that most Christians are giving them both. Most Christians in America are giving the humanists their children and their money. Well, if most Christians are doing that, who do you think is going to win this war? If we're giving the enemy everything the enemy wants, who do you think is going to win? See, the Christians of this country have got to wake up. They've got to realize that if they want to win, they've got to withdraw their children and their support from the schools. You see, once they withdraw their children, then they can go to court and say, look, it's unfair for Christians to be forced to support atheist schools. After all, the atheists are not forced to support Christian schools. So why should Christians be forced to support atheist schools?
Right.
Now, I have no objection to atheist parents educating their children as atheists, provided they do it in their own schools at their own expense.
Right.
But why should the atheists be the privileged special group in America that everyone else has to support with their taxes? Why are they the held up as the special privileged group in America? What makes them so special?
Right.
Why must everyone in America be taxed to pay for the education of atheists? That doesn't make sense. Let everyone pay for their own education. The only solution is to get government out of the education business and everyone to pay for their own kind of education and have their own schools. Let the humanists have their schools, Christians have theirs, and then we will know where we stand. That's the only solution to this problem, I see. But they will continue to tax you. These humanists, these socialists, these progressives are very clever people. You see, what is the aim of socialism? It's to destroy private property. That's what socialism does, it destroys private property. Do you know that the public schools have a lien on all of your property? You pay a property tax. You don't pay that tax, what happens? No property. You lose your property, so you really don't own property, do you? You're just renting it from the government. All you're doing is paying for the right to live in that property and to sell it to somebody else, to pass it on to somebody else. But if you don't pay that tax, you don't pay that rent, you don't live there. You're off. That property is confiscated. So you can see how public education has not only undermined the spiritual fabric of this country, destroyed children, destroyed education, but they've also destroyed the integrity of private property. How much more damage can we take from them? Why should we take any more from them? It's time for Christians to wake up and to realize that they have been had by this system. And they've got to do something about it. You know, our founding fathers gave us this great and wonderful country, and we would never have had it if they were not willing to take risks. You know, when they wrote that Declaration of Independence and they put their names on the line, King George did not hand them their independence on a silver platter. They had to go through 6 long years of bloody warfare and suffering before that declaration could be fulfilled. And if they had not done that, if they had not been willing to do that, we would not be sitting here today. We would not have this glorious and wonderful free country. You see the risks that are necessary. Now, all I'm asking of Christians in America to do something that might be a little inconvenient. You know, take the kids out of the public schools and put them in private school, in church schools. It'll be a little inconvenient. It's nothing like what the founding fathers had to go through to give us all of this. But if we don't do that, if we don't accept that little inconvenience, we're not going to have this free country to give to our children. Don't we want to pass on what was given to us to them? What are they going to ask of us when we're in the gulags? Daddy, what did you do to stop this from occurring? What did the Christians do to stop this from happening? Well, you say, well, we voted for a prayer amendment. Yeah. We really did the best we could. We didn't get our prayer amendments, so we sort of went home and forgot about it. No, we have to do much more. We've got to build Christian schools, Christian institutions, Christian magazines, Christian radio stations, Christian television stations. We've got to build a fortress of Christianity here that the enemy cannot break down or destroy. That's the message, you see. Our founding fathers set the example. And if we want our children to enjoy what they have bequeathed to us, we are going to have to follow that example. Thank you very much.